You guys excited today? All right, I would like to welcome New York Times bestselling author Chris Grabenstein.
Thank you guys very much. Is anyone here in the fifth grade?
Yeah.
All right. Behind me on that screen right now is my class picture when I was your age. I was actually once in the fifth grade, believe it or not. Has anyone figured out which one of those guys up there I was when I was in the fifth grade? Yes. Beside the teacher, that blonde girl, the guy with the striped shirt, looks like a sailor man. The one in front of him, her? Well, his hair is blonde. What color is my hair? What color did my hair used to be? Black, exactly. So look for someone with black hair up there. Yes, yes. The one in the blue shirt over here behind the teacher's got a receding hairline. Looks like he's going bald. I didn't start going bald till like 10 years ago. That poor kid was going bald in the fifth grade. By sixth grade, we were calling him Chrome Dome. That wasn't me, and I'll give you a little hint because I write mystery, so I like to give out clues. When I was in the fifth grade, my eyesight was much better. Glasses. No glasses back there. The one in the red shirt, that one right there? Well done! Yes, wasn't I a little angel in the fifth grade? That was me when I was in the fifth grade. Can you tell my mother used to cut our hair? So that was me. You know, I put that up there to show you that I was actually your age at one point, but also because in the fifth grade is when I first started writing. I wrote these little comic books and I would pass them around in the classroom, and my teacher suggested maybe I wait till recess to do that, but she encouraged me. And then in sixth grade, I did more writing. I used to write skits when we had talent shows in our schools. And then when I got to seventh grade, I had a teacher who wrote in the margins of my paper, "You will make your living as a writer someday." And from that point on, I sort of did everything I could to study writing and learn about it. And now I write all sorts of books. The first books I wrote for people your age, very appropriate this time of year, were called the Haunted Mystery Series. And it was a series of ghost stories starring a boy named Zach Jennings. The first book was called The Crossroads, and the second book took place in a haunted theater, and it's called The Hanging Hill. In the third book, he goes to school, and of course, there is a zombie in the basement, and that's called The Smoky Corridor. And the fourth book actually takes place around Halloween, and it's called The Black Heart Crypt. And then out of that second book, some friends of mine, I grew up over the mountains in Tennessee, so some friends of mine in Knoxville, Tennessee, asked me to write a play for them. So I wrote Curiosity Cat for them, and now it's being done all over the country. And then I wrote a series called Riley Mack and the Other Known Troublemakers, which is like an Ocean's 11, starring 11-year-olds. And then I wrote a book with a guy named James Patterson. Anyone ever heard of him, James Patterson? Yeah, he was my first boss many years ago. I used to write TV commercials with him. And he asked me to write a book with him called iFunny. Have any of you read iFunny? Thank you. That was my first book with my name on it to become a number one New York Times bestseller. And then we did I Even Funnier. That came out last year. And then we started, and I wrote this book called Escape from Mr. Lemoncello's Library. My mother can hear that applause all the way down in Florida. And it's been a lot of fun because Escape from Mr. Lemoncello's Library is the first book with just my name on it to become a New York Times bestseller. And this weekend, it'll be in the top 10 of the bestsellers for 20 weeks. And Nickelodeon might turn it into a movie. Oh, and then James Patterson and I wrote a book called Treasure Hunters. Anyone read the Treasure Hunters books yet? Those are pretty exciting. And we did a second book called Treasure. Oh, there's another Treasure Hunters down the Nile. And then we have a new book coming out. I think it's the Tuesday or Monday before Thanksgiving, called House of Robots. And the star of that book is a fifth grader, so you guys might find it appropriate. And James Patterson told me that's going to be half price everywhere the Friday after Thanksgiving. So wait until the Friday after Thanksgiving. And then in January, we have another on the iFunny books coming out called I Totally Funny. And that'll be out in January. And then before I wrote all those books, I wrote for the Muppets. Yeah, that was a lot of fun. I got to meet Jim Henson and his wife, Jane Henson. And yeah, we watched the Muppets. They're coming back. The Muppets are coming back. And then I wrote a long time ago, back in 1986, a movie, a Christmas movie called The Christmas Gift, starring John Denver. It's on CBS television. And it's still on every year. I know this because my mother calls up and tells me, she says, Chris, it's going to be on at 3 o'clock in the morning at the Hallmark Channel. And I still get paid every time they play that movie. Guess how much money I made last year from that movie? How much is it? A little less than $1,000. A little more than $1, buddy boy. Yes. $700, a little less than. $400, a little less than $400. Yes. $350, a little less. A lot less. Yeah. $230, a lot less than that. Yeah. $200. $50. $50. Yes. Yes. $25. You're like Mr. $1 over there. You would insult me and say I made $1 or $25 when you know I made $34.88. And then I split it with my partner and we both got $17 and bought double frappuccinos. It was an exciting day. Because when they play a movie over and over and over and over, they pay you less and less and less. But it's still kind of fun to see that still out there. And then after I did that, I wrote television commercials for almost 20 years. I wrote for Dr. Pepper and 7-Up and Kentucky Fried Chicken and Burger King. So, you know, I was doing the math the other day, and I realized that this December, I will have made my living as a writer for 30 years. I've been playing this writer game for 30 years. So I thought today I'd share with you guys some of the rules of the game, because this game is as much fun as any Lemoncello game. But I'll tell you a little bit about how I write stories, and then together, how about we write a story this morning? Would that be fun? All right, we're going to make up a story. If we make up a story, the first thing we need, of course, are words. Because everything that a writer does starts with words. Now, the kids have got here first. I asked you guys to write down words. Who wrote down words for me? All right, they're in my back pocket. I have not looked at them. Scouts honor, Boy Scouts honor. So I've got some words just in case I need them. Then the next thing I need, if I want to tell a story, of course, is an idea. And I go to like 30 or 40 schools a year, and I do like 200 Skype visits, and the number one question I get asked is, where do you come up with your ideas? And usually, I see something in my ordinary life that's a little bit out of whack, a little bit out of the ordinary, because nobody wants to read stories about the same old, same old, it was an average day and boring things happen. Things have to be a little bit out of whack for your starting point. And usually, I see something in my everyday life that inspires a what if. For instance, this book, The Crossroads, is all about this haunted tree and the ghost in it. I got that idea because most mornings I go out running. And I live in New York City, but we went on a little vacation up in the Berkshire Mountains in western Massachusetts. And I went out running. It was like 6 o'clock in the morning. A mist was upon the land. I went down this lonely country road, and I came to a tree that had a rusty bucket nailed to it, and the bucket was filled with plastic flowers that had been in the sun so long, all the color had been bleached out of their petals. Have you ever seen a memorial like that by the side of the road? Anyone know why they're usually there? Why are they usually there? What were you gonna say? Somebody crashed into a tree and died right there. So I'm running down the road, and I realize I'm going past a tree where somebody died. And I said to myself, what if the person who died right here doesn't like the fact that I'm running past the spot where he or she died? What if this person who comes out of the tree and chases me down the road and says, die, sucker, die. So I ran faster than I have ever run before. I think I put in a 6-minute mile. And I got back to the hotel and I wrote down, what if there was a tree that was haunted by the ghost of the person who crashed into it and died. And then that tree was on a farm. And then they bulldozed down the farm. And then they put up a new housing development. And then a boy with a really big imagination moved into one of those houses. And then that tree was in his backyard. And then all sorts of creepy stuff started happening around that tree. And then the tree started tapping at his window. And then lightning hit the tree. And then the tree split open. And then the spirit got out. You get the idea? You say, what if? And then you say, and then, and then, and then. And you say, and then, like 200, 300 times, you will have a 300-page book in no time. It's a lot like when I was in kindergarten, I would come home, and my parents would say, did anything happen in school today? And I'd say, well, Joey and Johnny, and then Johnny started crying, and then the teacher called the principal, and then the principal came into the room, and then Susie took a booger out of her nose, and then she threw it across the room, and then it hit the principal in the eye, and he started crying. So, just go back to your kindergarten self and say, and then, it's like, and then you know what, and then you know what, and that's how you start a story. Actually, stories are a lot like you get one idea, and that idea is like a rock, and you go to a pond where the water's really still, and you drop that one rock into the water, and the ripples will just start going out from there. And that's all you need to start a story, is that one idea, boom, and then all the ripples will come out. Now, for instance, the escape from Mr. Lemoncello's library, I got that idea when I was doing one of my school visits up in New York City. This is PS 10 in Brooklyn, New York. This is what all the schools look like in Brooklyn, New York. They're all made out of this kind of orange, red brick. They were probably built in 1930-something by the WPA, so they all look the same. So far, it's like it's same old, nothing interesting's going on. But then they said, come on upstairs and meet the kids, and they had this brand new library. It had solid bookcases that were filled with books. There was murals of all the kids' faces on the walls, little quotes around there, great lighting. And I said, wow, how did you guys get this great library? And the librarian there, Mr. Green, has said, ooh, a very generous benefactor donated it to us. So that day, on the subway ride home, I wrote down on my little note card, what if a very generous and somewhat loony bazillionaire donated a library to the town where he grew up? And I started saying, and then. And I worked on the book for 2 years. I worked on this book longer than any other one. And I rewrote it, I think, 8 different times. And then when the book finally came out, we had the big launch party and celebration in that same school library. And I donated a bunch of books in the Random House kid, and we raised more money to keep that library going. So that's typically, yes, you got a question. There were good questions at the end, but your hand's going to start falling asleep if you keep it over your head that long. Yes, what's your question? No, behind you. Yes. I should play Batman. We're going to write that down as a little note, and maybe I might play Batman a little later on. Okay, so that's usually how I get my ideas. But sometimes when I'm thinking about Batman, I go keep my eyes open enough and see things. So when that happens, I go to the internet, and I look for pictures where bizarre things are happening, because that might start a story. For instance, this picture right here. You guys see what's going on there? There's a man wearing nothing but purple underpants with the word FedEx emblazoned upon his butt. He has the flag of Canada draped over a shoulder, and he goes out to the airport with these little orange flashlights to park airplanes. Is this something you see every day? There's usually one kid who goes, oh yeah, I see that all the time. You should see meet my dad. But no, it's not something most people see every day. So now we've got our what if. What if there was a guy who went to work at the airport wearing nothing but underpants to park airplanes all day? So if you guys help me out and give me a couple story elements, I think we can make up a story about this guy. Oh, but before we get started, I write fiction. Does anyone here know what fiction is? Yes, what's fiction? Fiction is something that is not true. It's made up. It's totally comes out of thin air. It's telling lies for fun and profit. So, when I ask you guys for a suggestion, you can tell me anything at all. There is no right or wrong answer. All right, the first thing I need to do is find out a little something about our hero, our protagonist. Does anyone know what the word protagonist means here? What's protagonist? Yes. The good guy of the story, usually, what we're going to say, what's a protagonist? The main character. Give that man an advanced degree in Greek. Because protagonist comes from Greek words that means the main character. He's the one the story's going to be all about, or she, and usually they're the good guy. Like in the Star Wars movie, a guy named Luke Skywalker is the protagonist. So I need to learn a little something about our man in the underpants, our protagonist. What can you tell me about this guy? Yes? His name is Bob. All right. You know, as I said, I go to 40 schools a year and do this, and guess what the guy's name always is? Bob. That square pants is a strange hold on you people. All right, Bob. Now, what can you tell me about Bob? What makes him heroic? What kind of character does he have? Let's see here. Yes. Oh, he wears the underwear as a safety precaution. All right. The under, so he's very safety concerned, very safety conscious, I'll put that there, why he wears underwear. All right, now when I'm writing a story, the most important question that I have to ask, or you have to ask when you're writing your stories, is what does my protagonist want more than anything in the world? Like my hero, Kyle Keeley, wants to win more than anything in the world. So what does Bob, the safety-conscious airplane worker, want more than anything in the world besides a new pair of pants? Because that would just be too easy. Okay, double hands. He wants a girlfriend. Wants a girlfriend. Oh, young love. Okay, the next thing I need to know is where does our story take place? Now, I can tell it's taking place at an airport, but one of my favorite authors is a guy named Stephen King, and he wrote a book called On Writing. And in that book, he says that all writing is an act of mental telepathy, where I see something in my brain, and I put a few words on a piece of paper, and you see exactly what I saw in my brain. We have a mind meld. And the way that you do that is through very specific details. So, what can you guys tell me about this airport that makes it kind of special and different? Yes? It's in Mexico! That's why he's wearing the Canadian flag, okay. It's in Mexico. All right, now, we've got our protagonist, Bob. But in every story, if you're writing a story, what you want to do is have two forces that sort of collide all the time. So we got a protagonist, Bob, but every story has another character called the antagonist. Does anyone know what antagonist? What's the antagonist? Yes. The bad guy. That's usually what it is. Have you ever heard the word antagonize? I used to hear it all the time because I have two little brothers, and I'd go, my mother would say, Chris, put antagonize in your little brothers. What did she mean when she said that? Yes. Stop hitting on them over here. Say, what does antagonize mean? Yes. Bothering, annoying, jumping in the face of, getting in one's grill. So the antagonist's job in a story is to cause trouble for your protagonist. Like that guy, Darth Vader, is in that Star Wars story causing trouble for Luke Skywalker. So who is going to cause trouble for our hero Bob? Yes, the purple ears. You're the only one with purple ears. I'm sorry. A green slimy alien. All right. Does the green slimy alien have a name? What'd you say? Peter. A green slimy alien named Peter. All right. But why?
Why?
Because you see, villains and antagonists of stories, they don't sit around going, I'm going to do something evil today. They have a reason for everything they're going to do. I'm going to back here. Why does Pete the alien want to stop Bob from getting a girlfriend? Double hands. Because he wants underpants? He wants underpants, okay? He wants underpants. Alright, very good. He wants underpants. Don't we all? I wish I had some. Okay. Too much information. Alright, so now we've got all the story elements. What I need next, just to make this a little more fun, I need two sentences. But before you give me a sentence, who can tell me what two types of words must be in each and every sentence for it to qualify as a complete sentence? Yes! Punctuation and capitalization are two types of words. It's good to have those in your sentences, but those aren't the two types of words I'm looking for. Yes! A subject and a... Who can help me out with the second one? That would be the subject. A person, place, or thing, a chair, a country, or a king, that would be the subject or the noun. What's the other word I'm looking for? Yes! Predicate. What's another word for predicate? Yes. Oh, good. All right. We need a subject and a predicate, a noun and a verb. Who can tell me what's a noun? Someone already did. A person, place, or thing. And what's a verb? An action word like Batman might use. I got Batman on the brain. All right. So now I need two sentences, and they can be as random as you like. Don't have to do with anything we put down. Just make sure they're kind of short, like 5 or 6 words, and make sure they have a noun and a verb, because I'm not in the mood for fragments. Okay, way in the back with the blonde hair, stand up. Yes, what's your sentence? Okay, good. I woke up thinking about my job today. All right. I woke up thinking about my job today. All right, a little bit shorter for our next sentence. A little bit, my hand gets tired writing all those words. A little bit shorter, double hands. Who did? Yoku? J-O-Choku. Goku came to help me yesterday. All right, very good. All right, I'm going to tell you guys now a story. Yes, a story about a guy named Bob who wears underpants all the time, and he's kind of very safety conscious, Bob, and he wants a girlfriend more than anything in the world. Our story is going to take place in an airport in Mexico. And somewhere in the story, a green slimy alien named Peter is going to show up because he wants Bob's underpants. Now, when I tell you this story, the first sentence of my story is going to be, I woke up thinking about my job today, and the very last sentence of my story will be, Goku came to help me yesterday. So the next time I say, Goku came to help me yesterday, what are you going to do? Give me a round of applause. I learned this from some third graders in New Jersey. They call it a round of applause. Now, you know, it's kind of early in the morning, and I haven't written anything at all today, so there is a slight chance that while I'm telling you this story, I might encounter writer's block. Have any of you guys ever had writer's block? Anyone know what writer's block is? What is it back in the green headband? It's when you can't think of anything. You're staring at a blank sheet of paper and it's going, write something, or the computer cursor's going, write something, and you're going, I can't think of anything to write, I'm going to die, my brain's going to explode, I'm frozen. Well, that should happen to me. Well, I'm telling you this story about Bob and Pete and Goku. I am going to reach into my back pocket and pull out a word. And whatever that word is, it has to be the next word in my story. Do I have some good words here? I think I'm in trouble. They're smiling too much. Okay, here we go. I woke up thinking about my dad today. Bob said to his wife.
How dangerous it is here in Mexico for me to park those airplanes. And so, I decided to wear nothing but underpants to work. I believe the word FedEx on the back is printed in reflective tape, and if a plane gets too close, I'll just show it my butt. What do you think, dear?
And she said,
go, Bob, go ahead. I'm leaving you anyway. And his wife left him.
Bob went to work that day saying,
I got to get a new girlfriend. I've got to get a new girlfriend, and I'll take her on a date, and we'll go out, and we'll eat bread. We'll eat bread. We'll find bread and see what he's up to, and then we'll take him with us to bread. Oh, he's funny. The girls love bread. Huh? Bread, I'll take him on the date. We'll go out to dinner, and bread will tell jokes. I'll listen to him. And I'll get a new girlfriend. I got the offer called Brett, but after I go to work. And so he went to the airport, checked in with FedEx, and his boss said,
Bob, see, you forgot to wear the full uniform today. Why are you just wearing underpants?
Well, sir, I'm a little afraid of the airplanes I run into me. I'm very safely conscious. If I'm going to have a girlfriend, I'm going to be alive. So, what I thought is I wear the underpants, maybe put a flag over my shoulders, and then I'll be safer than anything. The only thing that would make me safer would be a dog. If I had a dog, it could come out with me and guard me out there.
And the head of FedEx said, let me get this German Shepherd if you want to take it.
And so Bob took the German Shepherd with him outside, and the dog was very clever. This dog could do all sorts of tricks. It could sit, it could stand, it could even beg for awesome sauce. And they sold awesome sauce in Mexico. It's what they called salsa down there. They had picante salsa and awesome sauce. So Bob was out there landing the airplanes, and all of a sudden, this very strange-looking airplane came. It wasn't an airplane. It was shaped like a dog. It was this big other dog, and the German Shepherd went, the dog ran away in this big airplane shaped like a dog with big jaws. Came down, and it didn't land like most airplanes. It hovered, it raised its leg, it let out all sorts of exhaust, and then it landed on the tarmac. And out of that back of the jaws of that airplane walked a green, slimy alien. Hello, Earthling. My name is Pete. I have come from the planet Belzar. We are here looking for certain items. The first thing we need, of course, is blue. We want the color blue. We do not have the color blue in Belzar. I went to North Carolina, but they wouldn't give me their blue. So I come to Mexico to get your blue. Please give me your blue.
I can't give you blue, man. Blue's like a color. How can I possibly
give it to me, or I will take your underpants. I like your underpants. FedEx is the king of our planet. We call him Lord FedEx on our planet. How dare you sit upon him? How dare you? If you were on Belzar, you would be taken in front of the king, and he would give you a fox. You do not want to get a fox from King FedEx, because FedEx's fox will just tear your face right off your head.
And Bob's getting pretty nervous right there, and he started going, come here, where's my German Shepherd? If I had a dog, then I'd scare us away. And he said, what was that dog's name? Oh, I remember. His name was Goku.
Goku, come! Goku, come!
The dog came over, hey man, you knew my name, that's pretty good. I can talk now. Because they said the first time that you knew my name, I could talk. This alien giving you trouble here, pal?
And Bob said, yes, his name is Pete.
Goku the dog said, oh, he looks nice and slimy. I like slimy food.
And in a flash, Goku the German Shepherd swallowed Pete the alien. Now, that night, on his date with Brett and the beautiful girls they went out with, he was telling a story about
he single-handedly dealt with an alien at the airport there in Mexico. And the girl went,
oh, senor, you are so manly. You are muy macho.
And then he said, yeah, that was quite a day yesterday. One of my best ever.
and I've adopted a dog, Goku, because Goku came to my help yesterday. Yeah!
Yay! Now, what I'm going to tell you guys is before I did any of that writing I told you about, I spent 5 years in a little theater down in Greenwich Village doing something called improvisational comedy, where we would get out in front of an audience and we would make up stories and songs and scenes from their suggestions. There was a young guy named Bruce Willis was in our troupe. He shaved his head, moved to California, don't know what happened to him. And then this guy, Robin Williams, was so sad when he passed away a couple weeks ago, because he used to come, whenever he was in town, he would jump up on stage with us and we would do scenes and stuff together. It was a lot of fun, and when you do improv, you just said there's only one rule, and that rule is to say yes to whatever comes up. Like when I pulled out the word dog for the second time, I could have stopped and said, no, dog's not the right word. I've already used the word dog once. What would be the perfect word? And I could have just stopped here and thought about it and thought about it. And that's where writer's block comes from, is when we think too hard and we try to make everything perfect the first time. But I have since known and realized in my 30 years that the first draft is just for you. You have to give yourself permission to write a bad first draft. Just sit down and say yes to whatever pops in your head, write it down, don't edit yourself, let it flow, and then go back and make it better. How many of you guys rewrite every single paper you turn in at school?
And how many of you are telling me the truth right now?
Really? You rewrite stuff?
Man, when I was in fifth grade, I'd start to get these little composition books with a marble cover, like,
la, 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 la. Oh, I'm halfway down the page, I must be halfway done. La, 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 la.
Got to the bottom and said, finished,
woohoo, here it is, and turned it in. But in all my years of writing, I have learned that the secret to all writing is rewriting. You write it down, get everything out of your head as best you can, and then you go back and make it better. Do you guys know Charles Dickens, right? He wrote, his most famous book is probably A Christmas Carol with Scrooge and Marley and all the ghosts. Well, in New York City, where I live, there's a library called the Morgan Library, and every December, they roll out under bulletproof glass Charles Dickens' original, handwritten, first draft manuscript of A Christmas Carol, and that's what it looks like right there. You see all those black marks all over it? Anybody know what's going on there? What's going on there? Yes, sir. He's revising his idea, rethinking his idea. He might be looking at that first sentence and going, oh, I've got two adjectives in here. I really only need one. Which one's the stronger one? And there's a whole section on the bottom where he's going, ah, maybe I don't even need this whole paragraph. I'll cut it out or I'll move it somewhere else. So whenever I'm getting frustrated, because I have to rewrite a lot. Like I told you, I rewrote Escape from Mr. Lemoncello's Library. I rewrote 50% of that book 8 different times over 2 years. So whenever I get frustrated, I look at this picture and I say, if it's good enough for Charles Dickens, it's good enough for me. Now, how was our first sentence? I woke up thinking about my job today. Was that a good first sentence? Yeah, I'm like, yes, you know, we really can't judge whether it's good or not unless we agree on what is a writer's number one job. What would you say is a writer's number one job, whether it's me writing my books or you guys writing papers at school? Yes. To write, that's why they call them writers. But what is the purpose of what we're doing? Yes. To let people know about your imagination? Kind of. But what's our job? Yes. To be creative, that's how you write? Yes. Yes, to grab a hold of all writers. All we're trying to do is to get readers reading, to get readers turning the page. How many of you have gone to a bookstore and you picked up a book and you read just like the first sentence? You go,
this is boring.
Put that book down, and you pick up another book and you read like 2 sentences. You go,
this one's even lamer than the first one.
Put that one down, and you pick up another book.
Ooh, this is pretty good. Ooh, I think I'll just stay here in the bookstore for the rest of my life and sit down on the floor and read it right now.
Because what we're all trying to do is get readers who stay up all night turning the page. Whether it's people reading my books or you want your teachers, I'm going, I can't wait to see what this kid says next. We do not want bored readers. Now I'm going to give you, this is the first sentence on page 1, chapter 1 of a book I wrote called The Black Heart Grip.
Zep Jennings did not want to chase a slobbering black dog with glowing red eyeballs up into the Haddon Hill Cemetery 3 nights before Halloween. Does anybody want to read what happens next?
Why?
What's going on in that one sentence? I'm here today to reveal all my tricks. What's going on in that one sentence that makes you want to keep reading? Yes, sir. Keeps you hooked, but how did I keep you hooked? Yes. You want to know more about it? Exactly. Do you guys know the word suspense? Comes from the same word like suspension bridge or suspenders. It means to leave your reader dangling in the air. Don't take them where they want to go right away. Leave them hanging. So that's excellent. You want to know more about the dog? What's going on here? It starts with a question that you have to keep reading to know the answer. Anything else going on in that sentence that forced you to keep going? Yes. It's 3 days before Halloween. And where is the story taking place? Yes. A cemetery 3 days before Halloween. We got a dog with glowing red eyeballs and a drool problem. Does that sound like there might be something creepy about to happen? So that's another thing you want to do at the top of your story is like leave your reader hanging and then make them kind of a promise like stick around. Something good's about to happen, and they will have to keep reading to find out what's going to happen. That's all in one sentence, but your whole goal is to hook your reader in and make them say, I gotta see what happens next. I gotta see what happens next. Okay, at this point, I need a few volunteers from the audience who are not afraid of making a fool of themselves in public. All right, sir, yes, back there, yes, you, come on up, yeah, come on up, and you, young lady, and you, sir, let me get someone from over here, and you, because you're close to the edge, okay, I want you guys, let's do it right over here, kids, oh, that's good, stand there, what's your name?
Maxwell,
good to see you,
Carson,
Charlie,
Taylor,
now Taylor, I want you to get over here, and you come over here, Charlie, stand right next to her, and you come over here and stand right next to her. Everybody face this way. Now, earlier, you guys told me there's two types of words in every sentence, a noun and a verb. Of those two, which one do I think is the most important word in any sentence? You have a 50-50 chance of getting this right. Yes, sir. Oh, yeah, a 50-50 chance of getting it wrong, too. What is a noun? Noun is a person, place, or thing. And what's a verb? Action word. So which one do I think is most important? The noun or the verb? The verb! Good, took a little while to get there. That's all right, good. Yes, the verb. Because a verb is an action word. And earlier I told you that all writing is an act of mental telepathy. If I pick the right verb, I can make you see exactly what I see in my head. And without changing the noun at all, I'll keep the noun exactly the same. I'll just change the verb. You guys are going to help me demonstrate this. I'm going to create a sentence, and I want you guys to act it out, just kind of walk over to where the projector is. Ready? The four students walked across the floor. All right, let's give them a round of applause. Come on back, guys. That was terrific. That was great. All right. Woo, that was excellent. How about, but you see those words up there? Every single word behind me is a verb that means to walk, but to walk in a different way. So I'll paint a completely different picture. For instance, has anyone ever heard the word trudge? What does trudge mean? Yes, Mill. Yes. March or walk with difficulty, like zombies trudging. It's like you're walking through the shallow end of a swimming pool, or you're walking through quicksand. So I'm going to keep the noun the same, but I'm going to change the verb and I want you guys to act it out. Ready? The four students trudged across the floor. Well, good time connection. All right. Excellent. Some of the best trudging I have seen. All right. How about to march? How do you walk if you march? Everybody knows that, right? Very middle person, the legs up. All right, so I'm going to keep the noun exactly the same. They're still basically walking, but I'm going to paint a completely different picture. The four students marched across the floor. Excellent, excellent marching. And that's the way you march in North Carolina, keep your arms crossed. I've seen the marching band, that's what they do. Okay, well, I'm marching, but I'm not really interested. That's good marching. Okay, now to do one more, another way to walk is to strut.
How do you walk if you strut?
Yes. Yes, you know. All fancy like, you're like really proud. Hold your chest up high. You say, look at me, everybody.
Okay, so now we're going to do the noun. It's going to be the same, but we're going to change the verb.
The four students strutted across the floor.
I think we found in America's next top model right here, ladies and gentlemen. All right, go sit down. Go sit down, you guys. Thank you very much. Give a round of applause. Alright, yeah, we kept the verb, the noun the same, we just changed the verb. Alright, so we're gonna move on to this. Oh, I always at this point like to ask, does anyone here like to hear nice stories about nice people having a nice day? You do? What's your name? You're in the orange Halloween shirt, yes. Sarah, and what would be the nicest breakfast you could have? You could have anything you want. What's that? Bacon. Okay, I'm gonna tell you a nice story about Sarah's nice day, and somewhere there will be bacon. Once upon a time, there was a beautiful princess named Sarah. And every morning when she woke up, five little bluebirds appeared out of the windowsill and went, chirp, 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 don't mean to scare ya, time to wake up, Sarah. And she said, oh, thank you, little birdies. What a nice way to wake up every morning. And then she went to her closet, where she had the finest silk gowns in the land and fluffy bunny slippers that were made out of actual fluffy bunnies. And they said, good morning, Sarah. Can we go? What's your name again? Sarah! And they said, that bunny said, what's your name, Sarah? She said, Sarah. They said, let's hop downstairs. And down they went to the practice room where her mother said, good morning, Sarah. Did you sleep nicely? And she said, oh, yes, Mumsy. I had the nicest dreams. I dreamt all about unicorns and narwhals. And they were playing volleyball with a marshmallow over the rainbow.
And her mother
said, nice, Sarah. Would you like some breakfast?
Oh, yes, Mumsy.
Would you like some bacon?
Oh, Mumsy, bacon would be delicious. I made 5 pounds of bacon just for you, Sarah. Here's a BLT. Here's a bacon omelet. Oh, Mumsy, you're so nice. I'm the luckiest.
Anyone bored with this story?
I am, because nothing's happening in it. Even Walt Disney, who gives you all these little princesses and little lion kings, knows that they are nothing unless they go up against a strong antagonist. Let's face it, little Simba does not deserve to be the Lion King unless he can deal with his Uncle Scar. And let's be honest here, without Captain Hook, Peter Pan is just a guy who likes to wear green tights. So, you always need conflict in your story, because in stories, as in real life, how you or your character act under pressure tells me more about who you are than anything you could ever say. So you always gotta be looking for conflicts that your characters can get through. All right, I'm gonna play one quick game, then you guys, I know, have a bunch of questions. So, we'll play one quick game with you guys, taking everything we've talked about, especially what we said about first sentences of books. I'm going to show you 3 sentences. One of them actually is the first sentence in the book I wrote with James Patterson called Treasure Hunters. Is it A, the sea was stormy and full of choppy waves, B, let me tell you about the last time I saw my dad, or C, once upon a time, there were 4 kids named Kid, and they were all treasure hunters. Who would pick A? I'd like to start with a little atmosphere. All right. Who would pick B? And who would pick C? All right. The correct answer, the first sentence chosen by James Patterson and myself, is B. Why did we pick B? Those of you who picked it, why did we pick B? Yes, back there. Kind of a random sentence had nothing to do with anything. Well, that wasn't a real thought process we went through, but I appreciate that, yes.
Exactly. You want to keep reading? We did that suspense thing we told you about where we're leaving you hanging. Some kid is narrating a book saying, I lost my father. Let me tell you the last time I saw my dad. And you're going, what? You've lost your father? What happened? Did he fall off a boat? Did he get eaten by sharks?
Did you lose your father at the mall? What happened to your father? So you're forced to keep reading to find out what's going on. The sea being choppy and full of waves, kind of what the sea does every day, so nothing exciting there. And I know the last sentence says once upon a time, or we're all used to stories starting with once upon a time, but come on, it says there's four kids named Kid, and they're all treasure hunters. You can tell that by looking at the cover of the book. So the second sentence is the one that builds some suspense. All right, I'm gonna stop talking now, because I know you guys have some questions. So who had a question earlier? Somebody had a question, yes. Are the scarier books good for children? Well, I wrote them for children, but you have to like scary stuff. They're scary and funny. They're kind of like a roller coaster ride. You ever been on a roller coaster where you go, ah, this is fun, we're just going up a hill, and you get to the top and go, ah, why did I ever do this? Ah! You get down the bottom, ah, it wasn't so bad, it wasn't so bad, I said, oh, there's another hill, ah, so I kind of write them like that. So it's like scary and funny at the same time. Yes. What was the most fun book to write? That's a very interesting question. I really had a lot of fun writing the book.